내일은 열심히 준비해서 좋은 모습 보여드리도록 하겠습니다.
Soki cracked under the pressure, straight up. Why did you just do that?
Yeah.
I know I got the ability, just gotta really like believe in myself and, you know, just make sure that I'm really in a good state of mind when I come to play tomorrow.
Oh no, he just has it with the Hellfire. Just
wow.
with the Hellfire.
Out of nowhere.
That is just going to be it. Monsoon has the victory.
뱀픽이 제일 중요한 것 같아요. 오늘 하면서 느낀 건데 뱀픽을 잘해야 될 것 같아요.
Peeping Ho vs Sogi, obviously going to watch their VODs pretty intensely. You know, just try and put together some deck lists, see what tech cards they're running that I can kind of play around and whatnot.
이게 네 명이 우리 같은 조에 네 명이 다 컨트롤 덱이 위주라서 누가 어렵거나 누가 쉽거나 그런 건 아니고 다 똑같은 것 같아요. 네 명이 다.
Community is a big part of why I love Hearthstone. Like, you know, some good memes going around, and like, there's some really good people in there as well. So yeah, just huge thanks to you guys. Like, you know, makes losing not so bad. To my future opponent, good luck, but you know, not too much good luck, and yeah, I hope we have some good games.
Neither of those players seeming like they're too confident going into today. But welcome back, everybody, to the Asia Pacific Winter Championship. I'm TJ. Joining me on the desk is Frodan. Frodan and TJ, together we make FroJ.
Well, hopefully that's not like, I mean, it doesn't definitely sounds not as appetizing as a nice summer dessert, but we'll take it. I was expecting a little bit better. TJ basically said, I have a great name for both of us as a duo. I wasn't expecting that one. I'm a little bit caught off guard by that.
Yeah, that was exactly
my goal.
Let's
just say the patent is under review.
That was exactly my goal, was to catch you off guard. But next matchup is between Naviut and Sogi, and this is going to be a pretty good matchup. Both these players, of course, coming off losses. This is an elimination match.
Yep.
And both of them struggled immensely. Naviut struggled because Matsune had a lineup that was really great against his, and Sogi just sort of, you know, crumbled under the pressure.
Yeah, definitely can see that stress was playing a huge factor. Whenever you just see him playing, it felt like all presence of composure was just gone. You could see that he was doubting a lot of his plays. In fact, he was taking a long time, even on some of the most obvious turns, and it was clear that he was split on decisions of overthinking it, and then as a result, just lost.
Yep.
I look at the Murloc Paladin Mirrors, for example, where he just gave Pimping Ho the win. He essentially conceded, so he's going to have to flip it around if he wants to win today and stay alive in the tournament.
All right, well, show these guys your support. Who do you think is going to win? Tweet with the hashtag HCT. And vote for either hashtag Naviut or hashtag Sogi. It's going to be a great match. And you could hear Naviut in his piece saying, you know, he's really thankful for the community support. And I know Sogi probably is as well. So definitely get out there. Let us know who you want to win going into this ever so important elimination match in the last match of the day.
Absolutely. And this is the point where it's the last match of the day, so some of these players have been waiting here. I mean, they had to watch all of the matches through and through, so some of them are fatigued. And hopefully that doesn't play a big factor leading to the series, because right now they need to play their best, TJ.
All right, well, let's intro the players. First up, it is going to be Sogi.
Hailing from the land of South Korea, Sogi comes in here as a player who prides himself on technical play, or at least so the bio says. Yesterday was definitely not his greatest day, and he said, as you saw in the CrossCut interviews, he wants to do better today. It doesn't matter how yesterday went, just win from this point onwards and we're good to go.
And his opponent, coming from Australia, it is Naviut.
Naviut, also known as Naviut to Canadians.
Or Navihoot.
Navihoot to ornithological fans, yeah.
Yeah, his name, is definitely...
Ornithology is the study of birds, TJ.
Thanks. Thanks for that.
Today you learned.
Today I
learned. Casting with me is so educational.
Today, TML. Today many learned.
Sure, sure. Well, you know, the thing about... Naviut that he learned yesterday, just to transition off of that, he learned a lot of dealing with pressure. I think Naviut was extremely nervous. He was asking me about information, like, hey, how do I deal with being under this kind of stress? You know, what's it like? What do you think about when you're competing at all? Because, you know, not everyone here has the most amount of experience competing on a stage like this, but even the smallest amount of experience can help you keep yourself composed However, the thing that ultimately set him, that thing I really liked with Naviyu when I was discussing with him, is that he says that in the end he's happy with the lines he took yesterday.
Yeah.
He said, you know what, I didn't play the best, but I think overall I'm very satisfied with what I do, and if I just play consistent, it should work out for me in the long run.
Yeah, and trusting in yourself is definitely a big deal. But let's take a look at the results from the poll. Who do you think will win? A lot of support for Naviyu. That's the most one-sided poll that we've seen here.
Yeah, it's not a surprise that Naviyu gets so much support. He has a lot of his friends out there on social media supporting him from the West. You know, a lot of players in the Americas and the European region. Naviyu practices with them. In fact, you know, a lot of the times that he streams, he has so many of the players in the chat moderating and talking about plays and whatnot. He's a very much beloved player within the community.
Yeah, and of course, you mentioned his stream. So there's a lot of, he has a lot of fans that just like to watch his stream and, you know, be entertained because he's a funny guy. He's definitely a character. But let's take a look at their deck lists. Druid banned for both players. And, you know, that's to be expected since both of these players' lineups are more control heavy, and they are punished pretty heavily by the Druid, with, you know, Freeze Mage for Naviyu, and of course the Murloc Paladin for Sogi. Both of those are definitely decks that are punished hard by Druid.
Mm-hmm. And then Sogi has also the Reno Warlock that we saw yesterday. Yep. The Warriors are still mysterious. The Control Warrior for Naviyu we got to see yesterday, but we don't see the Warrior for Sogi, so it's a little bit mysterious on that end. And of course, on Naviyu's end, he's playing not just a Freeze Mage, but he's playing the Torch Freeze Mage, which is a variant that Laughing and a few other people were successful even just last week with Naaman and Dr. Hippie being able to play those styles to perfection. But I'm looking forward to it, TJ. Game number one is about to begin. The last series of day number two. One player will stay alive. The other one will go home early.
Yeah, and I know both of these players definitely have a lot to prove. Sogi, he said he wants to prove that he's not the third best Korean player here, is what he said. And there's only three Korean players, so that would mean he was the last Korean player.
Absolutely.
And Naviyu, he said in his interview that the top end of Australia's talent is just not there, but he wants to prove that, you know, they can play with the best.
Naviyu starts off his first series with Freeze Mage, cues into a Control Warrior.
For the second time in a row, this happened exactly to him in his series yesterday. So, and in both matches, his opponent had Justicar Trueheart in close to their opening hand. So,
however, a few things have changed. The first is that Naviyu does have, hold on. It hasn't changed much at all. I completely mixed it up. I thought Naviyu had the coin, which does actually have some relevance. The coin does translate to extra cards as well as extra burn. So Naviyu's hope is this. His hope is that Sogi doesn't have a lot of plays early on. Mm-hmm. Navi can keep a lot of the shields low and he can draw cards. And ultimately one of his threats, whether it's Antonitis, whether it's Alexstrasza, he doesn't have Antonitis. His Thorsen, his Alexstrasza has a lot of mileage. And outside of that, though, he is going to be struggling a lot.
Yeah.
Because I feel like as soon as Sogi plays Justicar Trueheart on turn six, Naviyu is going to be basically on borrowed time.
Yeah, there's so many things that have to go right for you as the Freeze Mage player to win this matchup. One, you have to have Alexstrasza very early. So that's a check for Naviyu. He's got that. Two, you have to have the burn to follow up with Alexstrasza to kill them over the course of probably two turns, which, you know, he does have a good amount of burn in his hand and he has a lot of time to draw into it. And then three, your opponent has to not play Justicar Trueheart. So we can't check that box, Dan.
Well, Naviyu has an opportunity to stall if he wants.
That's true.
He's at the point where he has to really consider what he wants to be doing to prevent his opponent from having optimal plays. The reality is, Warrior never really truly has to win the game, but playing even Justicar Trueheart on the board, even into a Doomsayer, is still sometimes okay if you just want to pressure. It depends on how Naviyu's hand is also looking. Right now, he has a bunch of Blizzards, which isn't exactly what he's looking for either. Well, taking a look at Sogi's hand, Koi Justicar Trueheart, he knows the win condition to this matchup. Naviyu's not happy about it. I do wonder in the back of my mind, TJ, if Sogi saw the way Naviyu opened up last series and said, maybe he's just going to open up Freeze Mage again. Everyone knows he loves Freeze Mage. Why don't I just get this easy win out of the way?
It's exactly what I was thinking. And great tweet. Yeah, that's exactly what I was thinking. because Naviut, he opens with Freeze Mage, at least in a lot of the series that I've watched him, like all the time.
Sure.
Like even if you look back to his preliminaries, it was a deck that he's comfortable with. He opens with it so much. So that could have been Soki just doing his research. And another thing that we can see in Soki's hand here is that he runs an anti-Killbot.
Yeah,
his
that's
control
also
warrior deck.
Particularly interesting because the antique heal bot in a deck like Warrior, which already has so much extended healing, is somewhat excessive because you're replacing cards that would ultimately be more impactful onto the board. And you don't have to worry about your health total as much.
Yeah.
If you're playing cards like Sludge Belcher, it helps really defend your life. And you have ways to artificially raise it anyways through armor gains. So it's a very interesting card. I wonder if he's just cutting a little bit less spells and more minion-based removal, so that way he has more extended range against a lot of aggro decks.
Yeah. So Naviut is playing this matchup correctly. Basically, what you have to do is just keep the armor total as low as possible. It's okay to just throw burn spells at the face in the early game, and it's better than okay. It's encouraged because you need to keep that armor total low until the time that you play the Alexstrasza. And he is drawing into some more burn. He's drawn into that Roaring Torch after playing the Forgotten Torch earlier in the game. And he will have Alexstrasza on turn 9 if he so chooses, which he's setting up for it with the Doomsayer. So he's got a couple of the pieces lining up.
Yep.
But it's going to be so hard for him to get through all of this armor gain that Soki already has in his hand.
And Naviut's going to be looking to draw his Ice Lances, his Roaring Torches, and a Pyroblast. At this point, he's just going to go aggressive. And having the Alexstrasza in hand was really big in general to be able to even be in this position. Soki, on the other hand, he has 21 worth of healing just in his hand alone with the ability of tapping for 2 mana per turn into 4 healing with the tank up. So it's still going to be extremely difficult. Not impossible, because remember, Soki can't gain all that life at one point. But over the process of a couple turns, it's looking more and more unlikely.
Yeah, I think for it to even be possible, Naviut's going to have to draw like runner burn spells just for like 3 turns in a row. He's got Arcane Intellect. He's got Bloodmane Staunos, which can give him a little extra oomph with his burn spells and also, you know, cycle once it dies.
Naviut has a 27% win rate as Mage against Warrior,
yeah,
which doesn't look impressive on paper. But you have to remember that many players barely consider this like a 15 to 20% win rate ability. So the fact that he's almost double that is, in my opinion, highly impressive.
And that's across all Mage games. But if you know Naviut, I don't think I've ever seen him play anything other than Freeze Mage.
Yes.
So that definitely is pretty impressive.
Soki still feels pretty good here, even though I guess the actual way to remove this is to slam your own Grom, interestingly enough.
Yeah, if he values keeping that board alive.
Yeah, maybe you're okay just passing, Hero Power passing. Because the thing is, like, maybe you feel that you can just Hero Power and gain the life and just stay outside the range. You don't necessarily need to give up consuming your armor.
Yeah. It looks like he definitely wants to preserve this board. You don't really... this deck seems to be a little bit more minion heavy because it runs Sylphanas, which is a card that a lot of control warriors have cut. A lot of these removal warriors have cut, but he goes ahead and does it.
What's interesting is that Soki foregoes gaining life this turn so that he can preserve 7 power on board. You know, 7 power is pretty significant. But again, if you are in tune with what kind of deck Naviut has, he doesn't have Antonitis. He's just going to care about bursting you all in one turn. So life gain is still extremely relevant.
Yeah.
In fact, I wouldn't have been mad if he just played like a weapon and then tanked up at the previous turn.
Yeah, the thing is, at a certain point with this particular Freeze Mage deck, it becomes impossible to win because you have a finite amount of damage. With Archmage Antonitis, you give yourself the opportunity to produce fireballs, which, you know, increases the amount of burn that you have in your deck. But this deck has that finite amount of burn. But he does still have quite a bit left. He's got, you know, Pyroblast, he's got both fireballs, he has a Roaring Torch in his hand, plus in his deck, and both fireballs plus both Frostbolts plus both Ice Lances. So he definitely has what it takes to get there now. I can take the hit. But he's on a clock, he's on a time limit.
I think that time is almost past, TJ. 45 damage with this deck having no Antonitis seems extremely unlikely at this stage.
It's a 48 damage worth of burn total is what the deck runs after both torches have been used.
Okay.
And that doesn't include pings. That doesn't include Blood Mage Thaunos buffing it up.
So what you're saying is it's just impossible. He's already used he's already used some of the burn.
He's only used torches.
Right, but Sogi's going to start gaining too much life.
So as soon as Sogi passes like the 55-ish health mark, that gets rid of all the opportunities for Blood Mage Thaunos to make up the extra damage.
Emperor Thorzin gets no hits.
Yes.
So Navi might freeze the board one more time then, try to see if he can stall out by drawing with the Acolyte of Pain.
Yeah, but I think as soon as the second Shield Maiden's played, it becomes impossible.
It's tough. I'm not really envying Navi's position here. Sogi can once again, oh my goodness. He can once again play another Shield Maiden, tank up. And Navi, you tried. You really tried, man. It was a valiant effort. But I think it's time to scoop it up. You can definitely go as much as you want.
Oh, there we go.
All right. It looked like Navi was trying to see if he can go to distance, but showing off his hand, saying, you know what, you got me. But it's okay. I wasn't expecting to win this one anyways.
Gives that little sly smile across. Oh, man.
Cheeky
smile, yeah.
It's a cheeky smile. Wraps up game number one. Navi is not able to overcome Warrior once again, and Sogi gets a very nice, convenient game one victory.
Yeah, and that might be a nod to just Navi being a little bit too predictable with his opening deck choice. Bright side about that is Control Warrior is now out of the way, so it paves the way for the rest of Navi's decks, and of course that Freeze Mage pick up a win. Keep in mind, both players did ban Druid, so that's out of the way. That's another deck that Navi doesn't have to worry about facing off with that Freeze Mage.
So with that knowledge, I think Navi is going to be required to really target the Warlock here from Sogi. Now that he has his Freeze Mage, I mean, the Freeze Mage can definitely win against the Paladin or the Reno Warlock. Depends on how well he's able to navigate that matchup. But I'm looking at the Warrior also from Navi Ute, and Warrior does end up struggling a lot of times with the Murloc Paladin, just the overwhelming force that it has.
Yeah.
And then that last Warlock deck is a mystery deck. We still haven't seen it being revealed yet from Navi.
Yeah. Now, well, we saw Sogi talk a little bit earlier about how, you know, he's feeling a little bit shaky, but let's get to know Sogi a little bit more and why he wants to prove that he's not that third best player from Korea.
저는 25살 신동주고 예, 부산에서 태어나서 열심히 지금 하스톤 플레이하고 있습니다. 한국에 있는 창원이라는 조그만 도시에서 지금 살고 있고요. 창원은 다른데 한국에 가장 노래방이 많은 데라서 노래방 한번 가야 되지 않을까 생각합니다. 저는 잘 안 가는데요. 저는 집에서 많이 부릅니다. 스트림할 때 많이 부르거든요. 날 뜨면 전부 내 탓이지 뭐 마치 주인인 것처럼 제가 1, 2, 3 다 참가해서 예선전에서 초비에 떨어졌거든요. 그래서 이번에 안 되면은 그냥 하스톤을 가볍게 하는 걸로 바꿀까 아니면 아예 포기할까 생각하다가 올라가서 예선전을 또 그 전부터 한국에서 유명한 실시호가 있었는데 어떻게 그분이랑도 해서 이기고 4강 때 스틸로라는 친구를 만났을 때 그 친구가 중학교 때부터 오래 알던 사이였는데 아주 화대감이라는 접전 끝에 이겼는데 그때 가장 기분이 좋았고 사람들 평가가 좀 재미가 없을 것 같다 실력이 상대적으로 떨어질 것 같다 뭐 이런 평가가 있었는데 제가 이때까지 보여주는 것들이 작기 때문에 제가 제일 약하다고 생각할 수도 있는데 하스톤이 랭크만으로 결정되는 게임이 아니거든요 저는 딱히 딱 어떤 덱을 해야 된다 나의 스타일은 이거다 이런 게 없는 것 같거든요 모든 덱을 잘하는 수준까지 플레이할 수 있다고 생각하기 때문에 전략면에서 제가 좀 더 유리하지 않나 생각합니다 앞으로 보여드릴 모습을 생각해서 제가 제일 약한 사람은 아니라고 보여주면 될 것 같아요. 전 석입니다. 아시아 최강은 한국이라는 것을 보여드리도록 하겠습니다.
He is not the weakest link.
I love that his glasses have like that anime tint to it. You know, when you just kind of, when they push it back and all of a sudden it reflects all light possible in the universe. He kind of has that look, a little bit of a mystique to him, if you will. And he is. TJ said he's out to prove that he's not the weakest link here, at least for representing Korea. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of us can identify. You know, I'm trying every day to prove I'm not the weakest caster. And I think
we all know that you're not, Dan. We all know that.
I think you know, and just you know, as an actual side thing here, Soki comes in with like a player that's. It's much more methodical, right? He's not necessarily a very creative player. He's not a person that's very innovative. But he comes in here as a player that really wants to just play to the strongest of his ability. So he relies on good technical play. And so when you're relying on good technical play and not having creative lineups to really surprise your opponent in tournaments, and you're not executing on it, it's really a big foundational shakeup for you. Mm-hmm. You're just like, well, this is all I have right now, and if it's not working out, I'm in trouble. Yeah. However, he looked pretty solid. He made all the right calls in this freeze mage matchup. But that's the easiest obstacle down, TJ. He needs to continue that if he wants to get to his path to victory.
Yeah, Naviyu just threw him a softball for that first matchup. But Naviyu is sort of a similar player. He has definitely his style of decks, which is that control style, but he will bring what's best. He's very vocal about not liking Druid as a deck. But he'll bring it to a tournament if he thinks it improves his chances of winning. So sort of similar styles here with both of these players. And excited to see how it's going to play out. But we're going to jump into game number two of this final match, this elimination match.
Elimination match. However, it's not an elimination game yet. Navi still has some wiggle room. We're going to go to Renal Warlock versus the Torch Freeze Mage. This is a matchup that, in my opinion, is one of the most skill-testing matchups in Hearthstone, at least from something that's been birthed in the recent League of Explorers metagame. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The reason why is because there's a lot of ways you can misstep and be impatient with this deck. As much as you look at cards like Reno Jackson, and you start thinking, oh yeah, I can heal to full, there's no way I could lose. Freeze Mage players, especially the ones that have the Roaring Torch variants, actually have ability to collect up to 23 damage of burst, and thus putting a lot of pressure on Reno Jackson Warlocks, even at the 20 health mark. So sometimes, you know, they feel like they need to play Reno Jackson.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they just might die mistakenly to a huge combo.
And that's sort of the way that the finesse comes into this matchup is, as the Freeze Mage player, forcing the Reno Warlock into a situation where they want to heal, they want a Reno, before you use key cards like Alexstrasza. So if you can get them to use Reno Jackson before you use Alexstrasza, if you can fit in little chips of damage with your creatures like the Novice Engineer, like the Acolyte of Pain or Mad Scientist, and get some pings to the face early on, then you can really start putting on that pressure. And it definitely is one of the tougher matchups to navigate.
Well, this is certainly interesting. Soki just playing Sun Fury Protector on curve. He's not willing to tap, and he's not even willing to give up his coin so he can preemptively grab board control with cards like Imp Gang Boss. I think it's because it limits him the following turn, and he would have to play like the Mind Control tech. What do you think about that play, TJ?
It's decent. Yeah, he just wants something on the board, because as the chip damage really does matter. Getting something on the board to just contest stuff is actually a big deal.
I agree. I think having the Sun Fury Protector in this matchup is not particularly very important. Usually a Sun Fury Protector taunt, like what are you gonna taunt it up against that's usually attacking aggressively in the mid stages of the game?
Yeah.
Nothing really. So just playing it as a River Crocolisk equivalent, 2-mana 2/3, sometimes gets the job done. Now this is also curious. I was looking at Naviyu hovering over some of the cards. I was thinking Acolyte of Pain would make sense given the context that there's nothing that's 3 attack or higher. He ends up choosing an Ice Barrier instead.
Yeah, you want to sort of guarantee as many draws as possible out of Acolyte of Pain in this matchup. Just because you can just get out-pressured or lose because you don't draw enough, which is, you know, that's just the sort of the motto of Freeze Mage in general. Mm-hmm. If you don't draw enough, you are going to lose. But I think in this matchup, he wants to guarantee it as much as possible.
Okay, so he's saving for turn 5 to inevitably use a hero power Fire Blast onto his own Acolyte to draw an additional card. Yeah. I really like this patient play from Naviyu, which again, if he did get punished by a Dark Bomb or something equivalent of it, having the difference between 1 and 2 draws can be game defining. Sogi curving pretty decently. He has turns 2 to 4 set. However, afterwards, it's not exactly most well-defined. He needs 5 mana plays and higher, and cards like Shadow Flame and Twisting Nether don't really do much for his ultimate game plan.
Yeah. I want to draw attention once more to that pink face from Navi last turn. And it seems just really trivial, and it seems like, well, you probably wouldn't want to ping the Sunfear Protector anyway, but in this matchup, it's especially important to get those pings to face for the reasons we talked about earlier. I think a lot of Freeze Mage players sometimes get in the mindset of, well, okay, the only thing that matters in the early game is the board. I have to make sure
Board matters a lot, TJ. But what happens when the board says bye-bye?
Wow, Navi, you can't hold back his excitement on that one.
Yeah.
I can't wait to hear what the analysts have to say about how great that drop was.
He looks like a third grader after his teacher just said, but.
You know me so well, TJ. Right up my alley. But you're absolutely right. Sogi did say a funny. And to use it, I don't know if that's actually the English they use in Australia, but I'm just going to run with it. Naviut, I like it. Pinging the face once again, putting a little bit of light pressure. And the fact is, losing that board just means Sogi's pressure is reduced a lot. And it doesn't feel like that big of a deal, but it really does, because then all of a sudden cards get a little bit more value on the board for Naviut. So, Naviu picks up Forgotten Torch. It feels like one of these weird things, TJ, where when you play Forgotten Torch, you have like above 85% chance to draw a Roaring Torch the following turn.
I mean, even last game, he used the Forgotten Torch and like next turn he drew the Roaring Torch.
Yeah, and it's happened multiple times throughout the Hearthstone Championship tour. Something's a little fishy, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Sogi, doesn't really have great plays, but now that he has Emperor Thorazine, he can coin that out, and I feel like that's very good. However, the actual card quality in his hand is rather subpar. He has Mind Control Tech.
Yeah.
Twisting Nether, these don't really do much.
The thing is, his Reno Warlock deck, as we saw yesterday, is not very combo-oriented. The Emperor Thorazine's really just in here to, you know, get more value out of the cards that he has. And
sure.
Even though it doesn't seem like the cards that he reduced with Emperor Thorazine have that much of an immediate impact when getting that mana reduction, it's still going to be good. He'll be able to fit in maybe extra taps. We'll maybe be able to play that anti-kill bot in combination with something else later in the game that could get him out of range of Navi being able to kill him. So it just opens up more opportunities.
You know, at the same time, Sogi does have some cards that really do help him in tech. You know, the Earthwing Farseer being in his deck. That combined with a Brand Bronzebeard and the Antique Healbot, those heals add up over time. And the longer Sogi can stall without playing cards like Reno Jackson Healbot, the better it is. Naviut is getting a little bit close to his preferred range, though, and he has cards like Forgotten Torch, Roaring Torch, Frostbolt, Ice Lances. I do like getting rid of the Emperor Thorazine. I do think it represents too much of a threat as time goes on. Even though ultimately it's a card like that that gives you a lot of range to finish the game.
Yeah. And Sogi picks up Hellfire. Not really too useful except for Burst in this matchup. And this is sort of where this matchup becomes kind of tough. Your deck's filled with tech cards.
Right.
It's filled with situational creatures. Like when do you just start throwing stuff out on the board? How much do you extend? Where do you decide to apply pressure? And when do you decide to apply pressure? It's pretty tough. How many taps can you fit in? There's so many things that go through your mind when you have a hand filled with suboptimal plays.
Well, when you know that your opponent has played a Roaring Torch, it feels like you can still get away with one more tap, and you have a Healbot. I wouldn't mind tapping and then playing Healbot. The thing about Sylvanas is that card is so risky in a matchup like this, because Sylvanas will guarantee steal a Doomsayer if your opponent is able to set it up.
Yeah.
And then it's not even the fact that you might have it next turn, but every turn from that Sylvanas survives on the board is pretty scary. That's a great card to draw. I think he was looking for almost anything, whether Twilight Drake, whether he wants to pick up other mid-range minions like that as well.
Yeah.
He has a couple of cards that won't be useful in this matchup. I'm looking at cards like Exit of Swampoos and Zombie Chow, so he's just going to really hope to never tap into them.
Yeah, and of course, still hasn't drawn into the Reno Jackson. Earthring Farseer is another card that you mentioned, yep, which is exactly. a good body that also provides an extra bonus.
There's a lot of cards that are extremely powerful for Sogi that he doesn't have. Reno Jackson, of course, being one of them. You said Farseer, Brand Bronzebeard. Lotheb also being a huge one, especially when you can combine it with Brand Bronzebeard and Lotheb. You effectively checkmate the Freeze Mage. Oh, that's one of those cards that Sogi didn't really care about. Just happens to be nothing more than the equivalent of a Bloodfin Raptor if we were to follow the vanilla beast line.
Yeah, but you know, sometimes that can be pretty good. You know, he just saw Blizzard, so that can get in there for three damage. And looking over at Navi's side, you have to be patient with the Alexstrasza in this matchup is sort of the key thing to focus on. Is you can't just snap play it on turn nine. You usually have to wait until after they've used Reno Jackson before you use Alexstrasza, or else you just run into damage.
Even after Reno Jackson, sometimes you have to be wary of even Brand Bronzebeard and Healbot, which was kind of the same thing. Although one Healbot being used is really good news.
Yeah.
For Navi'ud, he's already happy. You see him nodding his head saying, okay, this is starting to get better. And a Fireball draw means that he's getting more damage in his hand. Currently that is 20 damage with the Forgotten Torch. So how does he piece it together? And if so, does he even want to start getting a little bit aggressive? It's hard to say because he doesn't know that Sogi doesn't have the Reno Jackson.
Yeah, you always have to... You can't really put your opponent on not having it.
Sure.
Is one of those things this matchup, because sometimes you can play around like weapon removal cards, or sometimes you can afford to not play around other specific tech cards. But Reno Jackson is so high impact that it's one of those cards that you can't just hope your opponent doesn't have it, because if they don't, you just lose completely.
Right. It's like, is this a situation where Navi'ud? Yes, by all means, if we had full information of hands, yeah, why not play Alexstrasza, right?
Sure.
However, he says, if I play Alexstrasza and he has Reno Jackson, I lose. Versus, this is not a situation where I have to be desperate enough to Hail Mary this play. Navi'ud also really calculating whether or not he can get away with using the hero power and playing it a little bit safer or being aggressive. And I don't think it's time to use cards like Frost Nova yet. Another bad draw here for Sogi. Cards like Siphon Soul is actually not the worst because it helps him gain a little bit of life, but he's still going to have to find a way to play something. Probably end up playing the Stygic Swampoos, and maybe that's it.
Yeah, that's really the only creature that doesn't have some type of drawback. You talked about the drawbacks of Sylvanas, Zombie Chow, of course. I mean, even though it's a body, it will heal up your opponent, which reduces the amount of pressure. And BGH... That's a pretty reliable removal for Alexstrasza. You do have Siphon Soul, though, so maybe there's an argument for playing the tempo, Big Game Hunter.
Yeah. In fact, I completely agree with that assessment. If you already have multiple ways to remove the big threat of Alexstrasza, I would use that. Oh, that's a really nice draw, too. Blizzard on a board like this to really soften things up, stall.
Yeah.
And just then you're able to just buy, buy time to hero power. Remember, he has 17 damage in hand. The moment he picks up the Blood Mage Thaunos, Navi'ud wins. Because he can play Blizzard, Hero Power of the Face, and then put him at 21. And the threshold is exactly at 21. Yep. Fireball, two Ice Lances, and a Frostbolt with Spell Power equals death.
And now that he's keeping control of the board, Sogi has been through a lot of those powerful, you know, the more powerful creatures in his deck, which is... You know, kind of surprising because it's pretty much just like Twilight Drake and Sludge Belcher, but
ho-ho.
He is in a pretty good spot.
He wants Sogi to play Reno Jackson if he has it. He says this is, like, basically I did the equivalent of playing Alexstrasza on you.
Yeah.
And so this is a power move.
But the thing is, it kind of works against him because Sogi doesn't have Reno Jackson.
Right.
So now that burn is... We know that it's kind of wasted.
Not really. That burn's just going to go to the face anyways, even if he had the
Oh, well, Thaunos. Yeah, I know, but I'm saying in a world where we do have that perfect information, he would have just Alex like two turns ago.
Sure. Won by now.
And won by now, exactly. So it's a matchup of mind games. It's a matchup of efficient damage.
Does Sogi feel like it's time to pressure more? He definitely doesn't feel comfortable tapping.
Yeah.
Tapping feels really awkward.
And also, if you tap, you give away to your opponent that you don't have Reno.
Right.
Because I'm
Well, it's already pretty obvious that he doesn't have Reno Jax. Yeah. 16 is almost as good as 15 in this scenario. Yeah. Sogi's not loving it. He saved his own heal bot.
Wow.
Nyviut has all the information of what Sogi's hand is. And plus, you can look at him. Look at the way he's twirling his hair. The way he's staring at the ground. The way he is stressed. There's the Thalnos. And Nyviut feels, I feel like he's in a really good position. Just need to pick up one more piece of bird. That last roaring towards the second fireball. And that should be the game unless Sogi can dramatically shift it around by picking up a Reno Jackson or a Lothep to stall it out.
I wonder if we could see just how many cards are left in Sogi's deck. Because that Reno Jackson could not come at a better time. But even if it does come, there's still the Alex Strauss left. 11 cards. So he's been through 2/3 of his deck and 9 left. Or Nyviut, and there's quite a few burn spells still left. I think one Roaring Torch.
Roaring Torch, one Fireball. Pyroblast itself, too.
Yep.
Nyviut setting up the Thanos ahead of time. This is interesting as well.
He's saying if you remove it, then you're going to have to use Hellfire and damage yourself. But you're just going to Owl it.
I wonder if he's trying to bait out the Owl now that his opponent used cards like Siphon Soul and the Owl, and then Doomsayer gets better. Probably not. I mean, I don't think you have an ability to protect Doomsayer very well.
Yeah, that Blood Mage Thalnos actually seems like it had a high amount of value just sitting in the hand and being used with the spells, because now it is susceptible to the silence, and now he doesn't get the extra spell damage. He doesn't get the potential draw.
Yeah, it's still tense. And you know, Lord Jaraxxus is also healing too.
Mm-hmm. It makes Reno Jackson worse.
It does make Reno Jackson worse. But in the event, say, Nyviut goes for a huge amount of burst setup with Pyroblast, Lord Jaraxxus can heal you right back. And Nyviut. Did he play a little bit too conservative? We'll see. Arcane Select is a really good draw. Oh, Roaring Torch.
And an Acolyte of Pain. So I believe he only has 6 cards left in his deck. And one of them being Fireball, one of them being Pyroblast. I don't know if we've seen 2 Ice Barriers yet, and I think we've only seen 1 Mad Scientist as well. So he's got a couple of highly impactful draws and a couple of pretty low impact draws left in his deck.
Nyviut's 1 damage off lethal, and that is something a little bit dicey just because he's staring at a lot of damage on board as well. He can just also not ping because he has the 18th point through the hero power. So he can even take this time to develop the Acolyte of Pain and force his opponent to probably spend some damage killing into it. And I think I would like that the most. So, Sogi now is in a situation where he needs to draw heal, or he is dead.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, that's going to have to come at the price of 2 health.
Yeah. So, he's got a couple of outs. He still has the Earthrimming Farseer left, which even after the tap would bring him to 19.
Right.
Which would put him 1 damage off of Nyviut being able to kill him next turn.
Right. There's Lothep as also a possibility. There's also Reno Jackson, the key linchpin to this deck. I mean, that's the reason why you play this deck. You play it for the Reno Jackson value.
Well, now he's just potentially given up.
Is he just going to pass? Even with a Farseer or Lothep. Yeah. If he passes, that's going to be it. Nyviut has the damage plenty over with that second fireball draw. Yeah. He's going to count 1 more time, but. Yeah. The mana usage is extremely efficient and a job well done. Even though we've known that for many turns in a row he had a large advantage, Nyviut played a very masterful game of Freeze Mage.
Exactly. Yeah, you can't expect your opponent to not draw into Reno Jackson like he did, but even if Sogi did have Reno Jackson, I think that Nyviut's line of plays in that Freeze Mage match would have led him to at least a close game, if not still a victory, even after everything was said and done. So. Very well played, and that's going to tie up the series 1-1. So we got ourselves a match.
It's heating up. Fireplace is quite big, and we'll see if Nyviut can carry up that momentum. Sogi, not really happy with just how the cards were falling. You can see that, again, he's very noticeably stressed.
Yeah.
And, you know, I asked these guys, I said, how do you feel before the match? You know, I try to gauge their temperature reading. And they were just saying, like, how can you not be nervous? This is an elimination match. I don't want to go home. I want to win.
Yeah. Well, Naviute tying it up. And I know that back home in Australia, Naviute has probably plenty of card-slinging suitors waiting for him. So let's get to know this Australian heartthrob a little bit better.
Yep.
My name's Alex Ridley, otherwise known as Naviute. 20 years old and from Australia. Perth is it's pretty isolated compared to most of the other capital cities in Australia. So it's got a pretty laid-back lifestyle, a lot of nice beaches and stuff, a lot of nice girls as well. But yeah, you know, loving it. Australia as a region is definitely perceived as the weakest region, and for good reason. It does have like a small player base and the top end talent isn't quite there, but I feel comfortable that I can compete with these players. I take a lot of confidence out of my ladder play, and it means a lot to me to come out here and represent Australia, mainly just like for my own career really. Been grinding away at this game for quite a while, and you know, to get some sort of like tangible reward, yeah, it does mean a lot. Yeah, I'm pretty rigorous with my sports, like outside of curricular activities, like did rowing and then obviously football. Yeah, do that like semi-professionally. It's made me a pretty competitive person, and that definitely translates to Hearthstone. I began streaming late 2014, and it's been a pretty long grind to get partnered with Twitch. As you can tell, 2014, 2 years is like a really long time, but enjoyed it tons. My long-term goals with Hearthstone, definitely all efforts focused towards building the stream, and you know, the means to do that, events like this, like building your credibility as a player, that goes a long way to, you know, wanting to tune in and watch you. You have to kind of decide, like, you know, what are your strengths, right? Like, what type of streamer are you? Are you an educational streamer, or, you know, are you an entertainer? And I kind of went with the entertaining side of it. And, you know, I'm a pretty emotional guy when I stream. Like, I definitely don't hold anything back. And, you know, if I'm playing against someone I don't really like, you know, I'll say that. But I do try and fit some education in there as well. Like, I'm not taking this weekend lightly. Like, I'm, you know, I put in a lot of work to win. Parents' reaction to this was that, you know, they thought it was a, you know, like scammers, right? Like, there's no way you're just gonna get kidnapped, thrown in a van. But you know, I'm here now, like, still here, haven't been kidnapped yet. This feels good. I'm Naviute, and I'm a tryhard who's going to win APAC this weekend.
You know, TJ, that's an impressive amount of memes per minute in that interview. I think Naviute is really well in touch with the community and just kind of like taking it lighthearted, but at the same time, like you said, he's a pretty big tryhard, really wants to win this one. And I think coming in here as, you know, from the Australia region, which is oftentimes underrepresented and underrated, honestly, I think he really comes in carrying a lot of pride.
Yeah, a lot of pride. Kappa pride, even.
Okay. All right. We're getting a little bit too literal,
look at that
man.
Poll,
subtlety is the soul of wit, TJ.
Yeah.
Come on. Well, something that's not very subtle is the polls. Taking a look at how people are voting, it looks like Naviute is overwhelmingly a dominating Sogi.
Yeah.
However, that doesn't necessarily translate to the results. We've seen Twitter polls and, you know, go one way, but then the series goes the other way. Mm-hmm. It is all up to the Hearthstone gods.
Yes.
AKA Ben Brode. Just kidding. Ben Brode was actually streaming earlier today, and he was just talking a lot about that. And then he hosted us for the stream. So
yeah.
Shout out to Mr. Brode.
Good guy, Ben Brode. Supporting Hearthstone in every way possible. But yeah, series is tied 1-1 now. And both of these players, you can tell just how emotionally invested they are in these matchups just by their expressions on the cameras in game, especially Sogi, who's constantly just like rubbing his hands through his hair and looking incredibly stressed out. Even right now, look at that.
Yeah, that is a really stressed Korean on the right side of our screen. And, you know, looks like Naviute's handling it much better. Momentum is a very real thing. Game number three about to kick off. We have Murloc Paladin up against some kind of slower Warlock. This is the first time we'll be revealing Naviute's Warlock here. And we still don't know what it completely entails, but Power Overwhelming does give a slight indication that it could be a Warlock that's slow that has a Faceless Manipulator combo in it.
Yeah, either, you know, Arena Warlock that uses that combo, or, you know, we can go old school and just as a regular combo Warlock deck.
Yeah, so that has Arcane Golem. It doesn't have, like, Jiraxxus and you know, Mal'Gas, some of these other like really slow heavy cards. It just has, it tops out like a Twisting Nether, and it has a bunch of cycle cards. That way you can get through your, basically get through your deck very efficiently. Yeah. And Navi commandingly taking the board. However, the thing is, Sogi could end up just being super defensive. And in the end, against Warlock decks that tap a lot and end up building a board, it doesn't really matter what you do. However, with that Faceless Manipulator combination, which comes into Navi's hand, that's one way you can push the pace. When you have Reno Jackson Warlock decks, a lot of the biggest problems is that you can't actually push real damage. You have to use the board. But if you have that 20 damage, 24 damage, it could be pretty insane.
Yeah, it adds that extra dynamic to this matchup. A matchup where, like you sort of mentioned there, normally you can't go above 30 health in most scenarios as the Reno Warlock. So eventually, if you're not applying pressure, you give the Murloc Paladin just time to draw into those Murlocs, draw into that Anyfin, and pretty much the game just gets blown out from there. But yeah, it does. It adds that little extra, you know, oomph that you might need to close out the game in a situation where that Murloc Paladin's struggling to find the game-ending damage.
So pointing out this Twilight Drake means that this Twilight Drake is pretty vulnerable to a lot of removal from Sogi. The first is like another Murloc, or even Old Murkai itself. You can't really touch it. And so Navi'ut ends up going for it, but it's just a 4-6. Not exactly the most intimidating presence out there on the block.
Still a body that has to be dealt with, that demands an answer.
Yeah, 4-6 or 4 mana is honestly not bad. It's just that we're so greedy as Warlocks, you know?
I think as Hearthstone players nowadays, I think we're just greedy in general.
Oh, okay, so it's about the new generation, right?
Yeah, back in my day.
Actually, back in my day, TJ.
We appreciate the 4-5 for 4 mana.
Back in my day, TJ, we played Mountain Giants in Control Paladin. That's almost as greedy. And Ysera. It doesn't get much greedier than that.
Yeah.
So I resist your notion that we are spoiled new generation uppity kids. Instead, I think Navi'ut will probably try to find an opportunity window to punish. In fact, that's why he's thinking so deeply if he wants to leverage the damage to face or control the state of the board here. The reality is, if you kill off this token, it makes cards like Solemn Vigil much worse. So I like this heads-up play from Navi'ut. He says, you know what? If you're going to play Solemn Vigil, play it for 5. Or you have to use, you know, Pyro Quality and then Solemn Vigil. But this is not a board worth using that at all.
Yeah.
So a really heads-up play that might have flown over the head of some people who aren't familiar with Murloc Paladin, but I love what Navi'ut's doing right now.
Yeah.
Big Game Hunter doesn't have many use to. If you are using Big Game Hunter for value, you most likely are dead because you're staring at a Murloc board that has a 12 damage Murkai, and he's just going to kill you the following turn.
I was thinking to myself, hey, Murloc Paladins don't even have any Big Game Hunter targets. Then I realized, wait.
I mean,
they do.
This one doesn't. We do know a couple paladins in this tournament that also brought Dr. Boom
Dr.
in.
Dr. Boom?
Actually,
that is correct.
We only know one, and that is Pin Ping Ho. The Shaman God. AK didn't bring Shaman to this tournament.
Yeah.
So he had a pretty important crossroads. Does he end up playing something for less value? He does. He ends up choosing the Antique Healbot. I wouldn't have blamed him for playing Solemn Vigil for 5 mana either. Even though it doesn't look pretty, the reality is your hand's really awkward. In fact, he has the very coveted 3 pair, which probably wouldn't win you a card game at the stakes, but in this situation, as a control deck, you don't want pairs. You actually want a lot of singletons, so that way you can mix and match different removal for the optimal situation, because right now his hand pretty much keeps repetitively doing the same thing, which is a quality of board, draw cards, and consecrate.
Yeah, the thing is, if you are going to have those pairs with pretty much all of that removal, Solemn Vigil is actually the card that you want to go along with it.
Yeah.
So of any of the 3 pairs of cards in his deck, these are probably some of the best. So he can be thankful for that fact, but still, definitely right. You want more separate cards for more options. But I still think he's in a reasonable spot.
Okay, so Navi'ut in this situation doesn't end up allowing... Like, now he's permitting Sogi to play cards and get a really good Solemn Vigil. He he didn't want to trade the big game Hunter. I think he's okay with him playing one Solemn Vigil, but two Solemn Vigil is really brutal, I think, here. And I'm almost certain that Soki wants to play another Solemn Vigil.
Yeah.
Drawing cards is so good for your game plan. I don't think the 1-1 token ultimately matters.
Yeah, it just contests, but he moused over for a second. I was thinking he was going to go for it just because of the way he's played, you know, throughout the earlier turns where he really valued having something on the board. Oh, well,
there's the
Arcane Golem, so he's assembling the pieces of the combo.
And I think now that he has even just 8 damage burst, I think he's even considering, like, what happens if I play Lotheb and Sunfury Protector? I'm putting out 10 damage on the board, and I'm putting him at 18. Guess what? I have the Arcane Golem and Faces next turn. That's 18 damage.
And locking him out of spells, too. So Sludge Belchers are drawn.
So Navi was secretly hoping to sneak up a lethal. Yeah. But it didn't work, and Soki ends up surviving, at least for now.
I like his thought process, though.
Ooh, okay. So he has Kazan Mystic in this deck. He really doesn't want to lose the Freeze Mage.
Yeah.
Because there's certainly not going to be Hunters. And it turns out Secret Paladins are not very popular within the Asian metagame. Mm-hmm. I mean, here's a big question. Soki doesn't really have much healing in his hand.
Yeah, Truth Server Champion is the only real form of healing that he has, but he isn't going to be able to clear the board, and, you know, Sludge Belcher makes it impossible for him to throw that combo out there, so still has lots of ways to block the damage. If we keep track of Murloc so far, I think it's just a War Leader that's died, if I'm correct.
Yep, you are correct. There have been no charges thus far. Anything can happen is basically dead, and Soki's best cards have yet to come. Power Overwhelming, that's 16 damage.
Can he get another Power Overwhelming?
Yes, he can! That is so huge.
Yeah.
And now, all of a sudden, Navi, as long as he can get past his last final taunt, it won't even matter if Soki... it won't even matter if Soki uses Lay on Hands. If he can get past the Sludge Belchers, 24 damage.
Yeah, and since he chose Arcane Golem as his combo piece instead of Leroy Jenkins, which is a choice that some people make, he doesn't even need Emperor Thorsand to reduce these cards in his hand in order to make that combo work.
One thing that Naviute has to also somewhat consider is that he doesn't actually have a way guaranteed to get past his Belcher this turn. So he has to spend even the next turn getting ready and setting it up. So it's a little bit of a slow process. I was expecting him to even play cards like Kazan Mystic, but I guess it's one of those things where he'd rather keep it tucked away. It doesn't ultimately matter because he doesn't have anything to benefit off Kazan Mystic, but I am a little bit surprised he chose to go for the anti-heal button. Yeah. I guess it doesn't really matter. Mana efficiency is pretty important. Do you Twisting Nether? Do you just Hellfire? Hellfire also makes sense, too, with the context of playing a Pile of Shredder, for example.
He's still got to get through that slime.
That's fine. Shredder is most likely to stick around.
Emperor Thorsand. Might just be the icing on the cake. He might not even need it at all to win
luxury.
This match.
TJ, having an Emperor Thorsand is... I don't know. It's basically... unnecessary at this point.
Yeah.
Even though you can make all of that into, what, 7 mana?
7 mana.
Or 6 mana, excuse me.
You could even play a Defender of Argus.
Right. The fact is, he only needs 1 Arcane Golem just to go through. This game is over.
Yeah. It is.
He has it. I mean...
Yeah.
Navi really likes killing people with major combos from the hand.
Yeah.
That's the takeaway from this game. And Sogi's like, oh god. Yeah. Oh, don't do it. No, Power of Overwhelming, number 2.
He knew as soon as that first Arcane Golem went down that it was over. So, yeah, that's just the power of this combo Reno deck as opposed to the more value-oriented Reno Warlock deck that Sogi ran. It can just win games out of nowhere, like we saw there.
All right, well, game number 3 is wrapped up. Now if you... putting Soki on match point, getting a pretty big win with the Warlock, and you know what, man? This was so crucial for him to win because you look at his lineup from yesterday. One of the things that he did, which was a little bit unconventional, even Brian Kibler was commenting on this, is that, you know, first of all, explosive sheeps are really fun and
little sneaky.
They're full
sheep.
Of surprises.
Get out of here.
Sometimes they come out of Shredder. Sometimes they come out in the middle of a broadcast. But the second thing is that he brought out the Warrior at a time where maybe bring the Warlock was a little bit better strategically because he didn't want to reveal the Warrior. And yesterday I was talking with Kim, like, well, what happens if he brings a very big surprise Warlock deck that we're not expecting? Zoo Warlock versus Reno Warlock is often a big split. But I said, what if he's also doing something similar to what Monson is doing, which is Malygos Warlock? Yeah. However, he brought a fourth Warlock, which is OTK Warlock in combo. So this was a huge move from the first series of Navi that he was planning from day number one to day number two in the event that he did lose, and it paid off in spades because you can see that Sogi was not prepared whatsoever for that Arcane Golem. I mean, maybe he thought of it in the back of his mind as a possibility, being at 10 health, but you can see that he wasn't playing with a lot of respect, nor did he have the choice to because he didn't have healing.
Yeah, no healing, no second.
Sorry, that was a really long explanation, TJ, but I hope that people got my point. That was a brilliant execution of strategy.
Yeah, and now Naviut's left with just the Control Warrior deck, but he's not out of the woods yet. There's still two really tough matchups for him to get through with the Murloc Paladin and that that slower Warlock deck, the Reno Warlock. So.
Yeah,
we still have a series on our hands. Sogi, even though he's down 2-1, he still has some good matchups left, and he's hyper-focused.
I hope so. I mean, right now, he's in a situation where I don't know. I think his back is against the wall. He has to use the Paladin right now to kill the Warrior. Murloc Paladin has been iffy, to say the least, for this tournament. It's been some of the reasons why players have won, but also the reasons why they've lost. Let's see if Sogi can turn it around in game number four, and if he doesn't, he is going to be finishing in third place, at least amongst the Koreans, which is not what you're aiming for, right, TJ?
I would hope so.
I would say that you're not. Your goal is to be more than that. Your goal is to be the champion of Asia Pacific.
Yeah. Yeah, I would definitely hope that you wouldn't be aiming to be the third best Korean. Unless the tournament was 100 Koreans.
Man.
Then you might want to be the third best. But when there's only three, no, not third best.
Couldn't agree more. Well, Sogi already in a difficult spot here. And now that he already knows Acolyte will get at least an additional draw, assuming he doesn't just use Equality here, which I think would be a little bit excessive.
Reporting for duty.
A very excessive.
Deny draw?
He's just going to Hero Power because he knows that he can't get away with it. However, Deathlord will introduce a third draw for this Acolyte, unless Sogi is willing to not Hero Power here. Okay, Consecration is also a possibility.
All right, so we talked about this matchup extensively yesterday, but let's give a little bit of a review. So a lot of players will say Murloc Paladin is favored in this matchup. And, you know, I tend to agree, but only slightly. There are things you can do as a Control Warrior player to fight back pretty handily. And one is getting Justicar Two Heart early. It's really important to start gaining life total and getting out of range of double anything can happen. The second thing is holding on to Belchers and holding on to Brawls until after the Anyfins are played, so that way you can block multiple shots from those giant Murlocs that are coming at your face.
That definitely could have been better, I guess, for Sogi, the fact that it's a 2-1 Murloc, if he had any semblance of board control. But the reality is on turn 4, almost anything that came out would have died. I don't know if there's any Battlecry minions that he would be really sad. I mean, if a Healbot gets pulled out, it wouldn't be bad, but I think cards like Sludge Belcher and honestly even Doomsayer would be okay because you just stall out the turn.
Yep.
Get some tempo.
Yeah.
Naviut having Justicar Trueheart in the hand is also a very significant deal. TJ brought this up yesterday, and astutely so. The armor count is extremely relevant as the game progresses, so the earlier you can get Hammond on that, the better.
Get Hammond on it!
TJ, I really want one day to just you to watch you prep my sandwiches before I head off to work, because I feel like it'd be really fun. Because you get excited over some of the most interesting things.
Flush it! Flush them! Ham it!
You know, if we ever come out with one of those toys.
Spread that mayo!
If you know what? I changed my opinion. I need a TJ motivational soundboard. Especially when I play Hearthstone and Murloc Paladin. I need to, like, TJ, what should I do right here?
Flush them!
reinforce. See, Sogi just passes. He's not even equipped a two silver champion. You can almost guarantee that Naviute will play Justicar Trueheart here on curve.
Especially playing it on a clear board, because it's actually a pretty significant body as well. I don't really know if there's a reason not to.
Well, alternative is to set up another weapon. I would be extremely surprised for him to tempo Big Game Hunter here, considering that he doesn't need to pressure like that. His deck is not really oriented around it. And Justicar Trueheart gives him the ability to tank up the following turns. Think of it as Justicar Trueheart is a bigger version of Big Game Hunter.
Yeah.
And you get to start making up the difference in hero power next turn. Yeah. Next turn, if you hero power and gain 4, it's like you hero power 2 turns in a row versus the Big Game Hunter. It is something worth evaluating, though. I mean, right now he's kind of weighing the balance.
He also might be just trying to, you know, throw Sogi off his game here.
It's true.
He keeps looking over at it, maybe trying to pick up signs of, you know, just anything. That's one of the sort of, I want to call it an advantage, but just extra dynamic in having a live environment where you can see your opponent as they make their plays.
One of the side effects, too, of playing cards like Justicar Trueheart is you guarantee that their Murlocs will die. They'll most likely trade into it. And, you know, Navi could also be considering the possibility of, like, as time goes on, he wants to make sure that he's optimizing his chance to survive against anything can happen, number one. He's at 26, and still no clear signs of being out of range of the ultimate wombo combo.
Yeah, so I think that's one Bluegill Warrior.
Yep, TJ getting the ingredient list ready. Mm-hmm. Writing it down. Noble Scroll. Or Squire. Whatever. Whoever takes notes during the meeting, because it's clearly not Brodan. Naviute, seeing a little bit of pressure here. I think the fact that Sogi didn't play Lay on Hands on turn 8 is pretty significant. He'd rather have board position to start leveraging against the armor count. And I kind of like that because he had plays to do. And a lot of times you might get suckered into, I want to draw cards. But if you can keep the armor count low, say he doesn't have a second weapon, he'd actually be in a decent spot here.
Yeah.
So I don't mind this at all. I also like killing the Murloc here with the weapon and using Shield Slam, because if he just played it really slow and say, like, he killed the antique heal bot and then armored up pass, he'd also be stuck in this position where the Murloc can get buffed by a war leader and then he can't kill it off as cleanly.
Yeah. Yeah, the armor count, we're driving it home a lot, but it is just super important in this matchup. So making plays that seem inefficient with your removal are actually super important, because you have to start early getting that armor total up, because it's important to get it 20 plus, 30 plus as the game goes on, so you can play around the maximum damage that anything can do. So,
yep. I do think that this version is weaker against Warrior than Pimping Ho's version.
Yeah.
Pimping Ho, of course, taking the Kalento approach to this matchup, where he brought Mini Bot, he brings Muster for Battle, and Dr. Boom. All those have much higher board implications. That's a pretty good draw here, by the way, from Naviute, having the Harrison Jones to shut down True Silver Champion. Does he want to attack with his Death Bite first?
Yeah.
That is a big question.
Yeah. And it looks like no. He's going to try and see what he's going to draw. So he's going to leave it up, and okay. I think this is okay. You can be patient with this. You're only going to take 2 damage on the backswing. If he decides not to attack, but he wanted to see what he was going to draw before. Even if he does swing here, he's putting a damage onto the Harrison Jones, which kind of seems weird, but definitely evaluating and seeing what he was going to draw first.
That is a painful parting between Naviute and his Shield Slam. He Shield Slammed this because he realizes that Sogi still has cards like Humility and even a second Peacekeeper in the deck. And knowing this, if he end up dropping it on Harrison Jones, that Acolyte draws an additional card. Unbeknownst to our Australian player, though, Sogi has so many ways to draw. He has the Lay on Hands, the Loot Hoarder, and a Solemn Vigil. So he's got plenty of options here.
Yeah.
Question is, what does he want to do?
You still want to make sure that you're developing a board, but I don't know. He also has to deal with Harrison Jones and a mix of developing board and drawing here is probably the ideal situation.
The end is coming!
Mind if
Okay, so this is a very aggressive move to force Navi's hand. Like, please attack with your weapon. You know, like in this scenario, I'm really looking forward. I was actually anticipating him playing Silent Vigil here.
Yeah, that's
That is pretty interesting. So, you know, I think Soki is in a situation where he wants to get more value onto board tempo, but he's not willing to draw cards here. Because the extra hero power here is somewhat irrelevant for Deathbite, so he's really trying to bait it hard for Navi'ud. And that's what's really surprising to me.
The thing is, he could have played Solemn Vigil and still hero power. He had 4 extra mana at the end of that turn, and Solemn Vigil cost 4. Doesn't seem like there's any reason not to play it.
He could be worried about fatigue, although that would be surprising. His hand is not even that strong. He wants to get more Murlocs in his hand.
It's not like you're getting that much further into fatigue. You're drawing 2 cards, but you sort of need to apply pressure to the warrior before their armor totals get out of hand. And right now, Navi'ud is definitely in a fantastic spot with armor. With only 2 total Murlocs being played, he's already managed to amass, after this turn, 20 armor. So
I would definitely consider attacking the Doomsayer here for Navi'ud. The reality is, the damage to face is almost negligible. He hasn't played any lay on hands. And so if you try to prioritize that extra damage to push and be a little bit greedier with like execute, a little bit faster with execute and less greedy, then in this situation, you might end up getting punished because Soki has an umpteen amount of ways to heal here.
Still just clearing the board, not really developing Murlocs to try and start pressuring, not drawing cards. Solemn Vigil, which could have been used 2 turns ago, still sitting in the hand. And now he's just going to continue to build up armor.
I'm wondering if Soki is also slightly overthinking things. Like, right now he's really hesitating before he makes a single move and then making it all in one swift movement.
It looked like he was not happy about the Golden Monkey, but the Golden Monkey is usually irrelevant in this matchup. A lot of times you can't even afford to use the Golden Monkey as a control warrior in this matchup, unless it's in a fatigue situation. Because Sledge Belcher is actually just better than Monkey, and you need Brawl to survive, so you can't afford to turn that into a legendary. So I'm not sure why he seems so upset that he saw the map. Maybe it's just cycle, but you know, that wouldn't have been in the deck in the first place.
Yep. I think he wasn't upset. I think he was more making a face like, I played Elise last turn and I got the map.
Yeah.
And he'd rather just have, more insurance, you know? He'd rather have another Shield Maiden, he'd rather have like his second Sludge Belcher, second Brawl.
Yeah.
Because you don't know if you will have enough time to draw all those cards. Shield block. You know, cards like Fiery War Axe help deal with the board here. And now he's going to be able to start benefiting off of killing off these 1-1s with the Shield Maiden. Before, you feel really bad having Shield Maiden kill off, you know, Silverhand Recruit. It's basically the worst job in Warrior ranks when you're relegated to Silverhand Recruit. No one wants to tell you to retire, because you're still kind of relevant, but you're at that point where you're just like, should I just call it quits here?
Yeah.
But the reality is just cleaning up Silverhand Recruits is just not a very flashy job at all.
Nope. Not at all.
When is Soki going to play his card draw for Lay on Hands? That's the question I want to know. And he's almost at the point where he has too many cards, so he has to drop a Doomsayer afterwards.
No, which is not the end of the world.
Oh, right. Certainly not.
There's one, anything can happen. There's number 2, but, you know, still some Murlocs to be played. He's got both War Leaders in his deck, if I'm counting correctly. Still has old Murka, as you can see in his hand. Bluegill Warriors have both been played.
Second Brawl comes to hand, which is pretty relevant.
Yeah. Now, basically, he's just a Belcher away from having all 4 cards that he needs to win the game.
And, you know, he does end up using Execute here, and he picks up Dr. Boom. Whoa. And now he's going to be able to eventually pressure the board. I love the fact that he's foregoing Dr. Boom here, going up to 61 health. I mean, 61 is still not exactly the safest, TJ, but it's pretty safe.
Yeah, it's pretty safe, especially combined with the Belchers. It just makes it so that 2 of the Murlocs that come out are going to be blocked. And even if you get the ideal amount of damage, meaning that you get the perfect combination of War Leaders, Murk Eyes.
Listen, man, the stars are aligning. The stars have definitely aligned. Soki has not been able to put on pressure. Naviute has dropped Justicar Trueheart on turn 6, has been tanking up ever since. And now the state of the board has been so where Naviute can actually afford to play it a little bit more aggressive with cards like Dr. Boom, meaning that Soki's chances of winning are slipping by the turn because he doesn't have his war leaders. They're all at the bottom of the deck. Very similar to how cards like Archmage Antennae and Alexstrasza being at the bottom of the Freeze Mate deck. This has gotten extremely tough.
Belch is a threat, but still not drawing into Murloc Ward Leaders.
Yeah, I love this with this non-attack by Naviute as well. He recognizes that if there's an opportunity for an opponent to play a Murloc Flood, he's going to need to brawl and remove a minion finally with the weapon. Mm. And he knows Dr. Boom and Boombots are more than enough to take out this measly squad of three attack minions.
Yeah.
Or so he thought. Until he teaches Dr. Boom to be a little bit more humble.
And then Dr. Boom teaches him right back.
This is my board.
Yeah.
Old Murkai has to come down eventually.
Yep.
Get chewing away at that health total.
It's not going to get killed off, though. He needs to keep getting that armor total down. And don't let that Golden Monkey fool you, Dan. I know how much people want to just slam the Golden Monkey every time it's in the hand, but this is not the match to be doing hasty things like that.
When you play when you play the League of Explorers wing, you actually your entire goal is to just take the Golden Monkey and get the staff. So I generally feel like it's a little bit a shame because I've been conditioned so many years. So many months to play the Golden Monkey Younger.
So you're saying for the past couple of months, you just keep playing the League of Explorers adventure over and over again.
TJ, I want to tell you a story that at BlizzCon 2015, there was the wing to escape the wing, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And no one could get the Golden Monkey because you only had 10 turns to play your decks. But only two people was able to do it. One guy who stood in line for 5 hours in a row and kept re-queuing to get the Golden Monkey, because that was an announced card. And the other second person?
Let me guess.
The second best caster at this desk.
Dan Frode. Oh, no, you set me up for that one.
Dan I got Frode it, man. Now, we didn't talk about this play at all.
No.
And I apologize. I took a step to brag about how I got the Golden Monkey at BlizzCon. But Naviute, again, parting ways with Execute, because he realizes his goal of winning is not having to be very defensive against the Murlocs before they spawn, it's after they spawn. So he knows the Brawl is the way to kill them off. Finally, Soki gets the Murloc War Leader, and now he can start making a real concerted push. But once again, the question just becomes, is it too late?
Oh, Grom is actually one of the best draws in the deck there, just because he needs an opportunity to start taking stuff off the board.
Oh, yeah. Oh, and by the way, it's a 10 damage threat, so you have to probably equality.
Oh, yeah.
Now, here's a question. Do you want to toss in War Leader into the equality?
Just to make...
Just so that you can play Anything Can Happen again?
I think it's kind of irrelevant, because it's going to be on the board anyway.
That's fair.
So whether you play it after or before, it's like it's the same thing. Until the second Anything Can Happen, because it'll...
The second Anything has to count the first one dying as well. So it does have a little bit of relevance.
That's
but
true. Yeah.
I think it is something worth asking.
Yeah.
By the way, Soki probably won't play the second Lay on Hands. It's going to fatigue him because he's almost down.
Two cards remaining. Neither of those are Murlocs because...
He's played both of his Bluegills.
He's played both of his Bluegills. He's played one War Leader. The second is in his hand, and he has played Old Murk Guy. So not quite sure what the other...
The first wave will do 22 damage. The second has anywhere between 32 to like 48, sometimes even 50 if you can maximize the amount of old Murkai's that get made.
But Naviute has put himself in a great spot going into those turns.
That is 70.
70 is the sweet spot, Dan.
Yeah, let's go. 22 damage, 23 with the Silverhand Recruit.
It's just not going to be enough.
Yep.
You just hold on to the Belchers. You hold on to the Brawls for this exact moment. He's going to Brawl next turn, Belcher, and I don't think there will be any way for Soki to push past the rest of the damage because he's still going to be at 43 health and it's going to be like a maximum of, what, 24 damage I can get through after two attacks go into the Belcher. And that's given the ideal amount of old Murkais and War Leaders that are going to come out of it. So. And then on top of that, he has the Golden Monkey after to contest it. I don't think Sogi has a shot.
He's praying. He's praying for maximum damage. Wait!
Ah!
Oh, he wanted to keep as many charges as he can. Oh, no! It's going to be close.
Nah. I don't think it was. Even if he did that turn, even if he got the perfect amount, I still don't think it was enough to push through that much health.
No, I think he needed a third Murkai.
Yeah, I needed a third Murkai. I needed another War Leader instead of a Bluegill.
Yep.
I do believe. So he's going to brawl here.
Oh, and another Belcher just to add the cherry on top of this delicious cake called Victory. Naviute is going to brawl the Murlocs away. And that is going to mean game number four will go to our Australian player. Unless Sogi magically whips out something, but it's impossible.
Yeah, he can keep hero powering, and at this point in the tournament, when your tournament life is on the line, when you're about to be eliminated,
now you play the golden monkey.
Now you play the golden monkey. All right,
let's monkey one time. I just want to see what he's gonna draw.
Come on, keep.
There's no reason why you shouldn't
monkey around. Let's do it.
This is a golden opportunity, TJ.
A golden opportunity to monkey around.
And Milhouse Bannister.
All right. Well, Sogi goes ahead and taps out. And that's Naviute surviving another day in the tournament. And unfortunately, that means Sogi has been eliminated from the Age Pacific Winter Championship.
A masterful performance to stay alive in the tournament. He was happy with how he played yesterday. And I think he should be even happier with how he played today. Very solid. Solid performance indeed. And Sogi definitely had his rough moments throughout this tournament, but I think it's a valuable learning experience. Again, you know, a lot of people from Korea who are watching along Sogi were saying this is a guy that probably won't, this is probably the best time for him to play and perform. He's a guy that usually understands the metagame, and he's at his best when everything has settled, but not for a guy who brought something a little bit weird. Naviute is a player who stands out in many ways here at this tournament. And he's going to advance in Group B to play Matsune tomorrow for the decider match.
Yeah, so that rematch is set. Naviute actually lost to Matsune yesterday. So definitely looking forward to that one and to see the second player to move on from Group B. But we do have our winner, Naviute, standing by fireside with Doa for a winner interview.
That's right. Hey, guys, I'm Doa here with Naviute. Just won the match, man. I mean, you didn't go so well yesterday, right? Lost to Matsune, came back, won today, but you lost game one. So my first question for you is when you're in that situation, how do you kind of deal with the stress? How do you sort of keep yourself in the game mentally?
Yeah, obviously, you touched on me losing to Matsune, and I really respect him as a player and, you know, the kind of style he plays. But as for losing game one, I just thought, you know, I had to kind of open freeze because if he didn't open with something that was other than Warrior, and he got a win with his two normal Warrior classes, like, it put my freeze really behind. So I kind of just accepted the Warrior loss. And, you know, looking at everyone's lineups, there's 7 out of 8 Warriors. So I think that's going to be a pretty common theme with my, you know, my matchup. So I kind of just accepted and move on.
So you're getting some practice with it. Now you're going to rematch against him tomorrow. Going to win this one?
Oh, I'm not really confident. Like I said, he's a really strong player, and his lineup matches up pretty well against mine. And, you know, I've got some inside information that he has the Kazan and his Warlock as well, so that doesn't really bode well for me.
A little bit more prepared, at least, though. So I've got a question for you that's kind of outside of the decks maybe in that matchup. We've seen a lot of Murloc Paladin. Well, the Paladins that have come have been Murloc Paladins, but no secret this time. Why do you think that is?
Look, I'm not too sure, but as far as, like, the APAC tournament goes, like, Murloc Paladin's a great call. At least on my side of the bracket, all the lineups are pretty heavy control. So, like, I think we saw Ping Ping Ho ban Murloc Paladin from Matsune. So, yeah, like, as it just shows it's a strong deck and people are respecting it.
Yeah, interesting stuff. So, here you are. You're representing Australia. You've won the match. You're going on to the final day. Do you have any kind of words of inspiration for the Australian scene back home?
Not too sure about words of inspiration, but just as far as, like, people in the chat or, you know, in the community go, like, I've seen you guys supporting me, and I do really appreciate that. So, yeah, it means a lot.
All right, good stuff from Naviute, guys. And thanks for checking out the interview. We're going to send it back to the sidebar where Papa Smithy and D2 are standing by.
Thank you very much, Doa. That was a really interesting series, D2. it was very well played. It wasn't the sort of explosive series where there's all sorts of different action scenes that we can reenact. But again, Freeze Mage was the story. We saw Navi struggle with Freeze Mage. It felt like the decks that came from Mattson yesterday really matched up well against Freeze Mage. First game, you queue into Control Warrior. We saw that game ended. The Honorable Sudoku just throwing his whole hand into his own face. No real hope of picking up the win there. But what I really wanted to focus on was game two, because I thought we really saw why Navi is so respected among the community for his Freeze Mage play as we get into our first replay.
Right, so many just intricate decisions to be made here. And the first thing we see is that Naviut could have gone for the Alexstrasza on turn 9, and he had the damage to finish the game out from, you know, 15 life left for Suggy, right? But, I mean, everyone at home, everyone, like the thousands of people are screaming, go Alexstrasza here, go Alexstrasza, you have the win there. I mean, obviously we see the heal button in hand, but, you know, you're not too worried about that, especially because Reno's not there.
And that's why he goes for the Blizzard, because you're doing the math. You can clearly see Frostbolt, Double Ice Lance, Roaring Torch, the Forgotten Torch into Hero Power. That's lethal on a 15 damage. Right. But we know that this Reno matchup especially has changed a lot when it comes to people's expectations of what to expect. Right when we started with this matchup, people said Reno Warlock countered the Freeze Mage just because, again, the full heal after the Alexstrasza, things are over. The deck since then has changed, and that's why we saw, as you could see, a very different line of play. Didn't go greedy, didn't look for the turn 10 kill, but played it out very differently.
Yeah, absolutely. There's so much fear in the side of the Arena Lock, because anytime you're around the 20, you know, basically the low 20s area, you're like viable to just die because of all of those, you know, all the torches in the deck and all of the other, you know, bursts available to the Freeze Mage. So that's why Naviut has brought this particular mage. We've been kind of speculating maybe there's no Antoniacin. Looks like that's definitely almost definitely the case, as I fill in my words. But yeah, I mean, a lot of intricate decisions there. And it was a situation where, I mean, Frodan and TJ touched upon it, that even if Reno was played, he likely would have taken the victory anyway.
And look, at that present point in the game, he had to test for Reno. That's what we're going to see in our second clip, is the testing for Reno, because he didn't get that information. He was playing around Reno in our first clip, just in case it was there. Now we're seeing the replay here, where he goes for a fireball to face. And to me, this basically says, you either have Reno or you don't, and now is the time to find out.
Exactly. Clear warning sign, just throwing that over to Suggy. Suggy doesn't have the ability to heal out of it, so he has to use the Siphon Soul in order to heal up to a certain point. And that's a clear indication, Naviut, that there is no Reno in the hand. And Naviut's saying, you know, I'm not really close to dying. I have a few turns here. I have double Ice Block. I've already frozen your board. There's not really much burst in Suggy's kind of more, you know, value-oriented Reno Lock. So Naviut sitting there, he's thinking like, okay, I got a few turns to work with. I have either I draw into burst or I draw into draw cards, which draw into burst as well. So I'm probably going to draw the burst necessary to kill him at this point. And, you know, from 16, obviously, even though he doesn't really have the damage right now. But he's just saying, you know, if you don't have the Reno right now, then, you know, or actually he's kind of saying, you know, I don't really care if you play the Reno, because he could just use the Alex anyway. So basically, it's good. Everything's good for Naviut. It's win-win. If you don't have the Reno, then I can just burst you down anyway. If you do have the Reno, I can use my Alexstrasza.
And that's the thing. You go back to the first play. It's all about, if there's Reno, this line of play is inappropriate. I have to play slower. That's why he went with the Blizzard. Then the moment that he sends Fireball Face, the moment that you're set to 16, there's no playing around. There's no ambiguity. At 22 health, maybe you don't play the Reno. But at 16 health, you play it or you lose. And that way, he knew that Reno wasn't there. From there, he took the victory. That was just his first game in the series, remember. But
that's first win.
Not necessarily video highlights from the next games. But let's talk a bit about the Murloc Paladin versus the Control Warrior matchup. You know, people were really throwing differing percentages. It's been TJ on the analyst desk and on the caster desk who's frequently talked about holding onto your brawls, holding onto your belches. And this, to me, was basically just the complete recognition of that line of thinking being very effective against the Murloc Paladin that has commonly been thought of as the real counter to this removal warrior.
Yeah, and not just that matchup, but also the Reno Lock, the OTK style Reno Lock versus the Murloc Paladin as well, showed that he knows how to win with two different styles of decks. And one is you burst your opponent down, and before that you kind of control the board. The other style with the Control Warrior is you basically try to take as little damage as possible. You saw him using bashes in lieu of weapons in that situation. Also knew that he had to have a weapon prepared for when he goes for the Brawl and the Sludge Belcher, you know, preferably. At the end, he had to get rid of his weapon, you know, to basically be more efficient. But he knew all the ways to win the game. And even though we don't have a specific clip, like every single little tiny detail, every single move he went through was key in picking up those two victories.
Look, he got the Justicar out early. It built up his life total. To me, the other interesting thing was very expertly played around Solemn Vigil. There wasn't really any turns when the Solemn Vigil value was massive. It felt like Sogi was being slow about playing those cards, playing the cycle, so gave it the extra turns for that armor total to hit. Just the massive amounts it did. And in the end, it was Naviut, my countryman, picking up the victory after what was looking like another difficult series. And guys, we're going to take a look at some highlights from that series and then come back to TJ and Frodan to close out the broadcast.
Well, then, it's been a great day of games. We've seen two players move on to the semifinals and two players eliminated.
That's right. It's a little bit of sadness, but in the end, this is what the competition is. Only one person gets to get that $25,000 as well as a ticket to the World Championship. And so far, it's been a really exciting run. Today, we've had a lot of big plays and big brawls.
That is right. So let's take a look at Group A and how that's played out over the last couple of days. We saw Handsome Guy qualify for that semifinals tomorrow in Dahuni, and UCCU will face it off at the beginning of the day tomorrow to decide that second spot for Group A.
Yeah, and over in Group B, we just saw Naviut survive elimination against Sogi, and we'll be playing Matsun tomorrow in a decider match early on before we go into semifinals to see if Ping Ping Ho can keep up that momentum after placing first place in Group B.
Yeah, it's I really like the style of decks that we're seeing. You know, a lot of people sort of, some people I'd say, sort of hate on the control style, but it's really refreshing to see after just seeing so many decks, so many types of decks in a meta that people were saying was stale.
Yeah, we've gone through the entire spectrum. We've had aggressive meta games coming through the Europes and Asia and Americas. We've had some combo oriented stuff, and now we're seeing a lot of the slow defensive matchups. Today is the longest broadcast we've had yet in the Winter Championship Tour, and I think it's really important to note that we've seen all kinds of stuff represented from all the way from Tier 1 even to the quote Tier 3 decks. And I think it's important to note that it's just the beginning, because tomorrow is where the intensity just ramps up that much more. So I can't wait to see what's going to happen then.
All right, well, let's take a look at the schedule for tomorrow. We're going to add an extra match. We're going to start off with those decider matches, and we'll head into the semifinals, and of course, at the end, the grand finals, where we will crown that Asia-Pacific Winter Champion and send someone to BlizzCon once again.
Yeah, it's going to be really fun. We also want to remind you that we'll be unveiling a new card from Whispers of the Old Gods tomorrow before the grand finals. That's right.
Yeah.
We got you guys all the way here to watch your favorite players, and tomorrow we're going to celebrate by showing you this awesome card that Blizzard has holding for the next expansion that's going to be releasing in late April / early May.
Yeah, I'm really excited for it, and you can check out oldgods.com if you've missed any of the card reveals that have taken place over the past couple weeks. But that's going to do it from everybody here at the Hearthstone Championship Tour. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you tomorrow.